Complex numbers are numbers that include a real part and a so-called imaginary square root of negative one part. I personally do not like the term imaginary, as it implies that hobbits and elves actually govern physics, rather than being useful stopgaps to deal with concepts for which we're not quite ready. That being said, we're stuck with the terminology. A little bit of history. Complex numbers were stumbled upon, possibly as a result of a sign error around the 1st century AD. However, the Greek mathematicians of the period were not even willing to accept the actual existence of negative numbers, so that discovery is pretty irrelevant. Chinese mathematicians fully embraced negative numbers and developed rules for dealing with negative numbers by the 2nd century AD, but they did not work with algebra, geometry, or trigonometry much, so they did not encounter negative roots. Mahaviracharya, a 9th century Indian mathematician, may have been the first to declare that square roots of negative numbers simply did not exist. Cardano, an Italian mathematician, is the first to publish complex numbers, while Raphael Bombelli, another Italian mathematician, was the first to describe operations involving complex numbers, which he called plus of minus and minus of minus. He saw that these numbers were necessary to solve quadratic and higher order equations. Descartes named these numbers imaginary, because he believed they were basically mathematical toys that had no relation to reality. Of course, we need to take into account that he had a difficult time in proving that he actually existed. It was not until the 18th century that the usefulness and practicality of complex numbers began to be fully embraced, as Abraham de Moivre provided the bridge between trigonometry and complex numbers. Among many mathematical accomplishments, Leonhard Euler discovered the relationship between trigonometric functions and exponential functions, giving us Euler's formula. E to the I phi equals the cosine of phi plus I times the sine of phi, which may be the coolest mathematical expression known to man, especially in the case of Euler's identity, where e to the I pi plus 1 equals 0. Think about that. All of the most important numbers in physical science in one formula. The irrational numbers e and pi related through the imaginary number, add 1 and get 0? Caspar Wessel was the first to describe complex numbers in terms of a real and imaginary coordinate system, though the coordinate system itself is called the Argand plane. I could continue, but at this point you might be noticing that the knowledge tree is starting to explode with famous names. The so-called imaginary number is a significant thing, not only for solving certain equations, but for describing physical systems. Many dynamic systems are described with complex numbers. They are used in electromagnetics, quantum mechanics, and relativity, all of which describe realities which we have to deal with. In electrical engineering, we are dealing with electromagnetics and quantum mechanics on a regular basis. Additionally, the expression of periodic signals is often most conveniently expressed in terms of complex numbers. In short, we use them all the time, and therefore need to know how to use them. I'm guessing for most of us, when we were introduced to complex numbers, they were a novelty of little importance, and we thought we would never see them again. With this in mind, let's start at the very beginning. In electrical engineering, we use J for the complex number. That's because we use I for current. And we use I for current because we use Q for charge. And we have to use Q for charge because we use C for the Coulomb. And capacitance. Sometimes there just are not enough letters. J is equal to the square root of negative 1. That means that J squared is equal to negative 1. J cubed would then be equal to minus 1 times the square root of negative 1, which we would write as negative J. 1 over J would be equal to 1 over J times 1, with 1 being expressed as J over J. This is equal to J over J squared, which is the same as J over negative 1, or simply negative J. That covers the behavior of the imaginary number when it's alone. Now let's look at some arbitrary complex number. We'll call it Z1. Z1 has a real component of magnitude A and an imaginary component of magnitude B. So we can write it as A plus JB. We can visually express this number on an XY type graph if we use the X axis to represent the real component of the number and the y-axis to represent the imaginary component of the number. So A would be the distance from the origin on the real axis, and B would be the distance from the origin on the imaginary axis. When an imaginary number is drawn in this fashion, we can see that it can alternatively be expressed in terms of a line showing the distance from the origin and the angle that line would make with respect to the real axis. We would write the complex number in this form, as r times the exponential function raised to the imaginary number times phi. So r times e to the j phi is equal to a plus jb. These are just alternate expressions of the same number. Some of you will see immediately that this is an application of Euler's equation, which relates the exponential function to trigonometric functions. If we multiply through Euler's equation by r, we see how to compute the real and imaginary components of what we will call the rectangular expression. The exponential expression will be called the polar representation of the complex number. So any complex number can be expressed in rectangular coordinates as z equals a plus jb, or it can be expressed in polar coordinates as r times e to the j phi. So for absolute clarity, if we have a complex number expressed in polar format and we want to convert it to rectangular format, we simply apply Euler's equation. This means the real part will be r times the cosine of the angle, and the imaginary part will be r times the sine of the angle. Looking at the graph, we see the rectangular components are simply projections of the line segment onto the respective axes. The graph should also make it easy to see how to convert from rectangular to polar format. We can see the length r is simply the hypotenuse of a triangle with sides a and b. So r will be equal to the square root of a squared plus b squared. The angle phi will be the tangent inverse of the opposite side over the adjacent side, or b over a. For any given complex number, we have two expressions for that number. The reason we have to bother with two possible expressions for each of these numbers is a matter of convenience. We will not just be writing complex numbers, but we will be doing computations involving complex numbers. As we will see very quickly, some computations need to be done in rectangular format, while others are easier to do in polar format. Let's look at some basic operations with complex numbers, beginning with addition. To make sure we have a clear picture to analyze the addition of two complex numbers, let's do it graphically. Let's say we have an imaginary number represented by the orange dot and another imaginary number represented by the green dot. The addition of these numbers is going to be very much like vector addition. The addition of the orange and green complex numbers results in the red complex number. If it's easier to see how this works, we can substitute in numbers. So let's say the orange dot represents 17 plus J10, and the green dot will represent negative 6 minus J12. The result is a red dot, which we arrive at by adding the real components of the two numbers and the imaginary components of the two numbers separately. So 17 plus J10 minus 6 minus J12 gives us 11 minus J2. When adding complex numbers, we have to add the real components of each of the numbers and then add the imaginary components of each of the numbers we're adding, and we have to keep them separate. That means we can only do addition and subtraction of complex numbers in rectangular form. So if we have a complex number Z1, which is equal to A plus JB, and another complex number Z2, which is equal to C plus JD, the sum of these numbers will be the quantity A plus C plus J times the quantity B plus D. Subtraction is performed in a very similar manner. If we want to subtract Z2 from Z1, we simply subtract the real components and the imaginary components. So Z1 minus Z2 is equal to quantity A minus C plus J times the quantity B minus D. Moving on to multiplication, if we take the same two arbitrary complex numbers and multiply them, in rectangular form, we multiply the numbers as we would any other binomial using FOIL. Multiplying Z1 times Z2, the first terms give us A times C. The outer terms give us J times AD. The inner terms give us J times BC. And the last terms give us J squared times BD. Remember that J squared is equal to negative 1, then Z1 times Z2 is equal to the quantity AC minus BD plus J times the quantity AD plus BC. Now let's look at the multiplication of two complex numbers in polar form. If we have a complex number Z1 represented by R1 e to the J phi 1 and Z2, which is equal to R2 e to the J phi 2, their product is the multiplication of their magnitudes, e to the j times the sum of their angles. So multiplication can be done in both rectangular and polar form. However, it's obviously a lot more straightforward in polar form. What about division? You might quickly guess that division is also much more straightforward in polar form. We should still go through division in rectangular form because it will add a new operation and reinforce some basic principles of complex numbers. If we take our same two arbitrary complex numbers and divide z1 by z2, we would write it like this. This presents a couple problems for us. The first problem is that we have a j in the denominator, and that's improper form. The second problem is we have no idea how to do this. Rather than try to figure out some twisted version of long division, let's look at the idea of the complex conjugate. To take the complex conjugate of a number, we simply change the sign of the imaginary component. The operation is denoted by the little star above the z. Here's what the complex conjugate does for us. We can take our quotient and multiply by 1 without changing it. Now, 1 comes in many forms, and in this case, we're going to use the complex conjugate of z2 over the complex conjugate of z2. Then we're going to FOIL out the numerator and the denominator. This looks a bit messy at first, but we can clean it up a little bit by remembering that minus j squared is simply 1, and then our expression simplifies to this. Then we can gather the real and imaginary terms in the numerator, and in the denominator, we can see the imaginary terms simply cancel. That is what multiplying a number by its complex conjugate does for us. It eliminates the imaginary portion of the number. Before we look at division in polar form, let's take a quick look at complex conjugates. Again, in rectangular form, we take the complex conjugate, denoted by z asterisk, of a number by changing the sign of the imaginary component. In polar form, the complex conjugate, again denoted by z asterisk of a number, will be taken by changing the sign of the angle or the exponent. These two operations are identical. If you do the conversion from rectangular to polar form, you'll see that changing the sign of the imaginary component is the same as changing the sign of the angle. If we're asked to determine the quotient of two complex numbers that are in polar form, we simply write the quotient of the two complex numbers. The quotient will then be the ratio of the two magnitudes times e to the j times the difference of their angles. So like with multiplication, division is a much more straightforward process in polar form. That covers the basic operations for complex numbers. As usual, it was not mathematically rigorous, but focused more on the practical functionality of the numbers. To review, in electrical engineering, we use j to denote the imaginary number. So j is equal to the square root of -1. There are two representations for complex numbers. One is a rectangular format, where the x-coordinate represents the real number and the y-coordinate would represent the imaginary number. The other representation is polar format, where we denote the number by its distance from the origin and the angle that a line to that point makes with the positive horizontal axis. We also learned that addition and subtraction of complex numbers must be done in rectangular form. We also noticed that multiplication and division were much easier in polar form. Along the way, we learned of an operation on complex numbers called the complex conjugate. This is a very basic introduction to complex numbers, but it is enough for us to be able to deal with the complex numbers we're going to encounter in introductory circuits courses. That's all for today. Go out and make it a great one.